Mr. President, family and friends, ladies and gentlemen, and if by any chance there's a member of the Conservative Party who's come to this lecture by mistake, you're also very welcome. I'm honored to be standing before you now. This lecture is important both for the content and for its sense of occasion. And now I don't quite know what's going on.
You have to wait.
We'll wait. We've got a very good technician who's already sorted out the music, so the text will come soon after. I think it's a bit small for people to read at the moment. I think we're going to have to...
Here.
That's good. So we'll go with this format. Okay. So this lecture both has content and a sense of occasion. It's an institutional ritual, the celebration of a collective cherished memory marking the passage of time. Foulkes' life, honored by the occasion, saw the publication of four major texts and the founding of a society and training institute to promote group analysis, our approach to groups. Now I don't know what to do to move to page two. I wrote this introduction, the words I've just read from, in 1987 to introduce Robin Skinner's Foulkes lecture, Institutes and How to Survive Them, when I put his selected papers together. This is Skinner speaking. To remember Foulkes and to thank him for the gift of his liberating influence, one of us is privileged each year to share with others what we've made of what we've received from him. And I'm happy that the honor has this year fallen upon me. Those were Skinner's words in 1984. Speaking for myself now, I too am happy that the honor has come to me, and I thank those responsible, the management committee of the society. My lecture is opened with four key questions, and I hope the territory for exploration will be marked out by its conclusion so we can continue the inquiry together through the weekend. I also want to express thanks and appreciation to Gwen Adshead, the evening's respondent, and to Thomas Miss and Lindy Watton, who will lead this study day tomorrow. I acknowledge your own contribution in the field and set much store by the guidance you've already given in the drafting of this lecture. I also wish to acknowledge the guidance I've had from Robbie Friedman and Claudia Arlo, and I want to say a special welcome to my own immediate family, who tonight join the group analytic family, and we have two different kinds of families coming together. So, four questions. What does it mean to be a group analyst? How do groups work with questions of attunement and alignment? Why are groups fruitful on issues of identity, longing, and belonging? And can group analysis meet the challenge of equipping people to free their destiny from their history? Now, before I continue, I just want to say you've all got a handout with these four questions on it. And the front sheet of the handout has these four questions, plus a diagram, and that's really the substance of this evening's lecture. On the reverse side is a table which is much too complex for a one-off lecture presentation, but what I want you to be able to identify is that the 12th point in the table, the last item, the three dimensions of psychotherapy, is what this lecture will be addressed to understanding. The table itself summarizes the scope of the book that's just gone to press. So this title, On Making a Home Among Strangers, will be looked at in terms of outside development that includes Foulkes' biography and the ambient network, the international frame of reference Foulkes spawned, fostered through the Society's work and the training institutes that now flourish on a worldwide basis. The same question, how we make a home among strangers, will then be considered through inside development in the work of small group psychotherapy, for which I've developed this model to guide our practice, the relational, reflective, and reparative. The lecture will be illustrated by four brief musical pieces, one of which was playing when you came in, which I will say more about briefly in a moment, and by four clinical vignettes. First, though, here's Skinner again. The forces of light usually stimulate a reaction from those of darkness. A method of pursuing knowledge, health, and happiness as powerful as the one that Foulkes taught us arouses in response powerful forces of resistance. The outward form of the event is designed as a kind of ritual, a magical ceremony designed to ward off the main dangers threatening our group analytic ethos. So to lull these opposing forces into a false sense of victory, we set aside one evening each year during which, as a paradoxical prescription of the behavior to be avoided, we do the exact opposite of everything we believe in. Seated in orderly rows in a crowded lecture theater, all facing the same way, the audience listens silently to a long monologue, following which even questions, let alone discussion, are most strictly avoided. And the audience departs feeling understandably virtuous, patiently sitting through a painful ordeal so alien to anything they believe in or are used to. We responded to Skinner's challenge in the year following, so the lecture by Murray Cox had a respondent with question time afterwards. We linked it to a study day, concluded by a party, and created what has been known as the May Weekend. So I want to ask you why you, the audience, should have to wait an hour and a half before anyone else speaks tonight. I propose we start the discussion before you get to the doors. In fact, let's begin right now. Without getting up and in groups of two, three, or four, whatever you find most comfortable, let me invite you to spend a few minutes talking to each other. Let us have some free-floating discussion. I'll interrupt you in a few minutes by returning to the music. Over to you.
Thank you.
When the music first came on and I thought people would stop talking, I did feel like a psychotherapist, a group analyst, come into the group room with everybody talking and nobody stops to begin the group. But thank you, and I'm sorry to interrupt your discussion. Foulkes introduced us to the term stranger group. What does it mean today? The Jewish philosopher Martin Buber says, all real living is meeting. The Buddhists have another fine precept that can guide us when they say, there's no such thing as a stranger, only a person we have yet to know. When we put our groups together, the art of composition rests on the recognition that we're all strangers, and whilst everybody is from elsewhere, we have the potential to be good companions for one another on the way to self-discovery. On the subject of making a home, we might ask ourselves, is this person at home in their body, with themselves, their history, circumstances, or career? Are they at home with their family? Children in play have a safe place to go called home, where you can't be put on. Refugees in flight have no place of safety, and as we hear daily in the news, when their homes turn into graveyards, they embark on fearful journeys. And when the land itself swallows its own people, in countries like Nepal, home itself becomes a place of danger. Watton explains in her account of musicality that when music is composed, it begins from or works towards a home key. This sense of being at home in a key to which all members of a group can resonate gives us the framework for attunement out of which a group's sense of meaning is built. The word home has meaning in the real world that Foulkes called the current level, and I prefer to describe it as the current domain, where we find refugees in camps, home cooking, or an island like Ithaca, the real island that was Odysseus' destination on his long way back from the Trojan Wars. Home also has meaning in the representational domain, and we talk about a home key, home cooking in a therapy group, or the Ithaca of Cavafy's famous poem, where it's no longer a real place, it's a metaphor furnishing ultimate reasons of purpose. Foulkes devised his simple categorization of a group's four levels that I suggest we rename as domains by differentiating between the real and the represented. He showed us further that the world as represented has three different regions, the transference, projective, and primordial. I'm exploring home as a figuration running through the life of my groups in each of these domains to extract moments of significance from the lives of its members so we can see how they help us make a home amongst strangers. Whilst a group has four domains of meaning, I'll give an account of psychotherapy in three dimensions that provide milestones on the journey towards home. I'll talk about myself, my arrival in this country as a political refugee from South Africa via Israel, and about other migrants faced with the challenge of making a home amongst strangers. Foulkes and his family arrived in the UK as emigres who, in flight from fascism in Germany, were given support by the British Psychoanalytic Institute that helped many such people settle here. We owe the term to him and to Anthony, who drew it from the sociologist Norbert Elias. Figurations capture moments in which a subject like home gains significance through the way its thematic content is even interwoven with process dynamics amongst those who generate it. As a figuration, home is not only a theme or subject, it colours relations amongst those who express it. As people in a group construct the picture of a home that was once safe but now lost, they can generate a sense of safety or one of loss and come to inhabit the very subject of our theme, safety or grief, through a process of enactment or recreation. In my groups, some remember home as the sanctuary of childhood. whilst others, people who could not wait to get away, remember precarious attachments in homes confused or left insecure by injury, abuse, or claustrophobia. Others remember home as both of these, a location that was both loved and resented, leaving in its wake a confusing residue of ambivalence later found to underlie other adversities. For some, home references are lost in the unremembered world, and for others, home itself was missing as the family lived an itinerant life. Some find home outside the group when they return to loved ones in the evenings, whilst for others, home has yet to be found anywhere. Some find themselves at home inside the group. It becomes the only safe place they've ever known, whilst others find it an arena of anxiety, persecution, or confusion. In the content of a group's associations, we find an emerging theme or subject that has bearing on the dynamics of its process. In the triangle between the past, there and then, the present, here and now, in the group, and the present world outside the group, process dynamics recreate the originating subject under discussion. These are the figurations of group analysis. So, questions 1 and 2. I'm guided exploring them by Foulkes, Antony, and Groucho Marx. Foulkes' view was that the role of a conductor was similar to that of a poet or writer, receptive to the current problems of his time and creative in expressing them. Antony believed group analytic psychotherapy offers an incomparable instrument, though still in need of a theoretical superstructure. Groucho Marx saying that he would not want to belong to any club that would have people like him as a member stands above the door of every consulting room in which group therapy is practiced. Most of us, when troubled, would expect to feel a lot worse amongst others with similar problems. A hospital, psychiatric ward, is not an encouraging place to go when in despair. In a prison setting, we know that criminals often reinforce each other's worst attributes. We also know that therapy groups, even for those in prison, work in just the opposite direction and can equip people to bring each other healing and change. How and why is this possible? Gwen Adsed will have more to say about this later. I first wrote about the language of the group in 1994. Wotton has extended this to describe the music we find in every group, and we'll be hearing more from her about this tomorrow. For now, I'll call on her account to describe how music, how human communication rests on our innate musicality. Only by aligning ourselves alongside one another through being in time and in tune can we make sense of what Mead calls the conversation of gesture and response. Our shared frame of reference is made up of figurations that link the dynamics of a group to its language. Along with the three language forms, monologue, dialogue, and discourse, music can be taken as one more, or as a language embracing all the others, giving tone and color to issues of attunement and alignment. The musical pieces that illustrate this lecture are selected to capture and illustrate mood and tone. In all groups, even as large as this, we can align ourselves with each other by being in tune and in time. The music playing when you came in and the music that interrupted your talking is by a South African jazz musician, Hugh Masekela, called Home is Where the Music Is. It's performed by a group of South African political exiles in London in the early 1970s. And it gave spirit and solace to many of us extruded from our homes by a violent political process, as Foulkes was in his own time. In 1933, he and his wife left Germany overnight with their three children to avoid the surrender of passports required of Jews under new Nazi statutes. Most of those who surrendered their passports were trapped and later perished. The definitive account of Foulkes' life is by his widow Elizabeth, and of his contribution to group analysis by Malcolm Pines. Excellent papers by Bleeden, Levine, Nitzken, and Miss provide more biography, including valuable discussion about his name and identity. What do we know from Foulkes himself about his feelings about his homeland, Germany, and about his language, about the city of his upbringing, Karlsruhe, about the cities in which he studied, Heidelberg and Vienna, or about the city of Frankfurt in which he settled, married, had his children, and established his practice? what do we know of the family that perished? So far as I can make out, the answer is very little. Thomas Miss will share with us tomorrow the fruits of his own investigations that shed valuable light on these questions. There are indirect and oblique references to his love of German culture in his writing, through which we can see that some of its landmark figures, Goethe, Schiller, and Heine, never left him. But throughout his writing, his oeuvre, home is a missing figuration. There is no home music. It's as radically absent in his writing as it appears to have been amongst the majority of German Jews who came to this country as refugee psychoanalysts. At the end of James Anthony's own life, this is how he remembered Foulkes, who, he told me, lost so much that had been his own in the Holocaust. He came to the UK to live and take up a professional life in an alien language. He established a wartime service that matured to become a way of understanding people and relationships, generated a therapy that opened up for us a whole new field of endeavor, whilst he lived through a world war in an adopted country and alien language, through a divorce with his first wife, and the untimely death by cancer of his much-loved second wife, Kilmeny. He was the man, said Anthony, whose resilience helped me to find my own. But the price he appears to have paid for this extraordinary resilience is the loss of a personal history that could be passed on to others. The collective tragedy that was the Holocaust left many of its survivors shocked into silence. The influences that shaped our society's international frame of reference are neither circumstantial nor accidental. The gifts of cultivation were not self-generating. They begin with the man whose life we celebrate, and then, thanks to the training initiatives and programs extended by many of you here tonight, group analysis is now rooted in the professional life of many countries. Those who followed Foulkes most immediately extended the ambient network along different pathways, including the journal group analysis, the program of Foulkes lectures, by which I'm honored tonight, and the International Library, all three of which we owe to Malcolm Pines. And through international training programs, in which he and Liesl Hurst made early and extended contributions, and I do want to take this opportunity to express a special greeting to Liesl here tonight, who is, I think, the only person here now. Perhaps there are others, I'm trying to remember. Yes, there's Earl here, and who else? Who knew Foulkes personally? It's an interesting question. What's going to become of this legacy as those who once knew him pass on? We had hoped Malcolm would be here tonight, but unfortunately, he's not well enough to come out. Here is just one story about the ambient network and its growth. I'll be brief. At the Amsterdam Congress of the IAGP in 1989, we met Russians free to travel for the first time. One of them explained that though he spoke Russian, he was Lithuanian, and curious as I was, because that's where our name and grandparents originate, and I told him so, I avoided him. The records we have describe the key role Lithuanians played collaborating with the Nazi Einsatzgruppen in the mass murder of all but two of our large family in 1941. I'd never met a Lithuanian before, and despite my curiosity, kept my distance. As I left the Congress during our free afternoon, he saw me going out and proposed joining me. I explained there was something personal I wanted to do, and when he asked what it was and I told him, he replied that was exactly what he wanted to do. So we went to the Anne Frank House together. When we came to that point in the memorial where you see in the upstairs attic room the height of the children marked on the doorpost in pencil with their names, dates, and ages, as the children in hiding get older, you see the point in time at which the marks stop. And we both became silent. On coming out, we were both tearful, and I told him my daughter was now the same age as Anne Frank when she'd been killed. Through his tears, he told me in turn of his own daughters of the same age. We embraced and have been friends ever since. He's come to stay in my home. I've been to stay with him in the home of one of his daughters, who, like my own, is now a mature adult with children of their own. I'm honored to say that my own daughter Hannah and her husband Martin are here tonight. Down the years, my Lithuanian colleagues introduced us to the Jewish State Museum of Lithuania and went on to play their own part in helping us find drivers, translators, and guides to find our ancestors' earlier grave sites, those locations where they're buried with dignity in cemeteries, and then the massacre sites where those living in 1941 are buried in the killing fields of Europe. So here's a story of two strangers recognizing we're part of the same human family who made a cord across a terrible divide and took steps together on the long process of reparation. There are now group analytic training institutes in different countries of the former Soviet Union, including Russia and Lithuania, that members of this audience have played a key part in establishing. And they in turn have hosted us as speakers on many occasions. We're going to come to the second piece of music, but I'll just say something about it briefly. There is more about the music on commentary sheets relating to the music that you can collect on your way out after the lecture. But I thought it would be more valuable to hear the music before you read about it. We can better understand the significance of a secure base, get a purchase on what it means to be at home, by appreciating the life situation of people facing the threat of its loss. In Vilnius, now the capital of Lithuania, there was a Jewish population in the city and its area approaching some 80,000 people when the city was overrun in 1941, few of whom survived. The song that follows is sung in Yiddish, our grandparents' language, and celebrates the home city of its composer, known as Vilna in Yiddish. This vernacular language is based on medieval German from the Upper Rhinelands with an additional Hebrew vocabulary. It was a language spoken by most of the 6 million and survives today in fragmentary communities. In our home, it was the language our grandparents spoke to one another and to our grandparents when they didn't want us to understand, so I learnt it to make sure this didn't happen. The song was composed in the ghetto that the Nazis created. Its occupants were turned into a workforce to service industrial activities servicing the German war effort. Those redundant to purpose were taken out for execution on a regular basis. When the ghetto was finally liquidated in 1943, only a handful of partisan fighters survived. But their doomed uprising sparked a turn in Jewish life. So could we have number two? Vilne Yiddish lachartera Ues murem len stile tviles Stile seides von der Nacht Oft mal seh ich dich in Hohen Heis geliebte Vilne Alte Wilner Ghetto in a nebeligen Schein. Wilne, Wilne, unser Heimstatt, unser Denkschaft und Baguette. Ach, wie oft es ruft dein Name. Und mei Heuger Eisatre Wilner Gesslach, Wilner Teichen Wilner Wäldelbark und Boh Es neuet, es bängt sich noch die Zeit Sein Schlafen eingehielt, wo geheim es haben Lehrer, unser Wissen durst gestillt. Viele konnten erschen fallen, von der Freiheit von gewährt.
Wilne, unser Heimstott, unser Bengschaft und Baguette.
So we come to insight development. Foulkes defined the common zone in which all members can participate and learn to understand one another. The zone of communication must include the experience of every member in such a way that it can be shared and understood by the others on whatever level it's first conveyed. Before embarking on the series of four vignettes, I wish to make clear that those whose experience is described here have all given their written consent where it's recognizable, in line with the code of practice of the IGA and IPA. So, vignette number one. Two new members joined a small group. Leon in his 30s had a promising career, and Sandra, a health professional in her 50s, had adult children elsewhere. His presenting difficulty was a serious gambling problem, and hers, finding love in the second half of life. His upbringing involved maternal neglect, and hers an aggressive, volatile father who bore down on all his children, especially her older brothers, one of whom became a dissolute gambler. During the first four sessions, they each shared something important about their lives, and both showed signs of settling until he revealed the severity of his gambling habit and described the pressure he struggled against. The discourse that followed was led by a subgroup of women to whom Sandra recounted the ruinous consequences of her brother's habit, the distress this brought to the family, and the estrangement that followed. Later in life, she had him to her home for reconciliation, only to discover on his departure that he'd stolen precious things to feed his habit, and she had nothing further to do with him. On revealing her unease about joining a group that had a man with habits like Leon's, she told us she was considering leaving. He became subdued and troubled that because of him, she might not want to stay. He cut into the women's discourse, appealed for her return, and assured her that he would not steal her things. She was startled, touched, and then tearful, and she did come back. They're both well settled in the group and making progress 1 year on. Her negatively projected expectations of others are shifting to appreciate people's novelty and individuality. He, in turn, is taking an account of gambling as a masochistic protest. The harm he does himself, brought to the attention of those now concerned for him, serves as retribution against them for what they once did to him. He is steadily finding ways of expressing the anger about his upbringing in less destructive terms. These aliens became allies in the intermediate territory of the group, the transference domain, in which she faced her brother across the room, and he, determined that she not reject him as others had done, assured her that he would not steal her things. But how could her things have ever been in danger? This wasn't her home any more than it was his. They'd both made a home amongst strangers, and from their shared unconscious, he assured her she would be safe, using reference to her things as a metaphor. His continuing determination to keep her safe is playing its part in his slow, uncertain recovery outside the group, and her discovery of his good faith is shifting her own deep despondency about the male gender. In this vignette, all three of psychotherapy's dimensions, the relational, reflective, and reparative, arise in a synchronous way. Arlo provides the promising notion of paying love forward to explore stories in group therapy where gratitude is transposed into generosity. In her account of reparation between siblings, when one of them has the benefit of group therapy, she describes how the group itself becomes a reparative arena in which you don't pay love back, you pay it forward. It goes out to the people around you in the group who've helped you to bring you to a new threshold of development. All seven of us in the circle became witnesses to a reparative dialogue between these two based on empathic mirroring, which turned into discourse round the circle as people resonated to the sense both of injury and resolution with other stories of their own. We move on now to the next piece of music, but before we hear it, I'll just tell you briefly that it comes from the album Graceland that Paul Simon put together with the South African group Ladysmith Black Mambazo, and it's sung in Zulu and English. The lyrics speak to the subject of tonight's lecture. The two songs, Vilna and Homeless, can be taken together as musical idioms that capture some of the essentials of what people seek in groups.
Sing.
Homeless, homeless, moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake. Homeless, homeless, moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake. Homeless,
we are
homeless, the moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake.
We are
homeless,
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 boom, boom,
the moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake.
Somebody cry, why, why? Somebody sing. Somebody sing,
hello, hello, hello.
Somebody sing. Somebody cry, why, why?
So you can hear how these are musical analogues for the difficulties that bring people to therapy. And just to share something more immediate and personal, when we saw those terrible pictures of Nepal and those people in such terrible straits, this was the music I put on to see me through it in that terrible night. So in the discomfort of the homeless mind, there is a longing for home, grief over its loss, false hope in its idealization, and you might have heard that in the song about Vilna, and real hope in its restoration. Now we come to the three dimensions, and I should just take a time check to see what we've got.
20 minutes.
20 minutes. So I think we should...
No, sorry. No. Quarter of an hour.
Okay. So 5 minutes for each dimension. Psychotherapy provides a therapeutic relationship to help a person develop a reflective understanding of themselves and others through which reparation can promote healing, growth, and change. The three primary dimensions can guide our practice, and the three R's provide a conceptual framework, a kind of tripod that supports the work. I devised this account because of a growing sense of unease that in our field's developing literature, there's a tendency to mistake the vehicle for the journey. A group is a therapeutic vehicle, but it's not the journey itself. Group methods are set apart from individual psychotherapy by the fact that here you gain not only by what you get, but also by what you give to the experience of others. In group therapy, you're conveyed by the vehicle you help to create. The conductor's challenge is to set a course that allows a group to develop reflective moments out of relational ones and reparative moments out of the reflective. The relational dimension is the first and most fundamental. It generates relational moments in which bonds and conflicts arise through attachment and friction. They're not only benign or affirmative, some of the most profound relational moments involve conflict, hostile opposition, or malignant mirroring. They lay down the substrate of a group's experience, generating the sense of an auxiliary ego, first described in group analysis by Rebecca Neild, called the group as a whole, or the matrix. It becomes a container or the fabric for everyone present, providing a foundation for both the other dimensions. At the next level, and arising out of a group's relational work, is the reflective dimension, generating reflective moments that can be defined in both of two ways. The first involves self-consciousness, a sense of critical inquiry applied by the word reflective. The second involves the discovery of symbolic meaning. Arising out of the relational and reflective dimensions is a group's reparative dimension. Reparative moments can arise in highly charged cathartic experience or in quiet moments of resolution. They can also be understood in different ways that include, first, remorse and concern, the development of guilt and the capacity to make restitution, and second, the corrective recapitulation of primary family experience. This is what Yalom brought from the writing of Alexander in French. This is the figure you have on the handout, and I'm not going to spend time exploring it now. Let's go straight into the vignettes. But you can see what it's trying to say. The top is the relational. On the right is the reflective, and bottom left, the reparative. And psychotherapy is always circular. A therapy that eventually becomes reparative is then further enriched in its relational significance. The inside set of arrows shows how these three dimensions are always in dynamic relation to one another. Each dimension builds on the one that goes before, and as they progress, they lead to insight, outside, reality testing, and self-discovery that take the business of change to progressively deeper levels. Outside is a term first introduced by Desmarais, then by Pines, that it identifies how that which is found in another, seen or recognized outside the self, gives access to what could not otherwise be owned in the self. We'll see more of that in a moment. Here's the relational dimension. This is vignette number two. A group of eight men sit in a circle with two therapists for the first meeting of what will be a two-year program in a clinic providing services for refugees. They come from countries in which torture is endemic, have all been profoundly injured, and what they have in common in their different countries of origin is prior experience of violence and multiple traumatic loss. We struggle through introductions that falter and halt. People refer their questions to one or other of the therapists from whom they expect answers. We're occasional and cordial participants, but consistently refer back to the group. There's silence followed by limited narrative sequence. We're enabling, but the edge to people's anxieties is inhibiting. All new groups begin like this, with a form of what we can call serial monologue. 30 minutes into it, one of the men, Mustafa from Iran, asks where the toilet is. He is directed by one of the therapists. Everyone sees him gather his crutches from beneath his chair and limp across the room to the door. He was already seated when other members arrived, so until now, only the therapist knew how handicapped he was. We watch his move, every move, in a kind of charged silence that remains unbroken whilst he's out. Later, the door opens, and watched by everyone, he struggles across the room, back to his seat, stumbles into his chair, perspiring from the effort, and finally replaces his crutches beneath his chair. Jonas from Rwanda has visible scarring to his face and neck and speaks with a commanding French accent. He looks at Mustafa and, leaning towards him, he says across the room, "My brother, what did they do to you?" There's a long pause. With the reply, the room fills with relief and real exchange. Mustafa speaks in broken, faltering English about how soldiers at home broke his back with a rifle butt and boots. He goes on to tell us he's lucky to be alive and how his family saved him. He describes his escape and tells of his wife and baby. And this relational movement that moves us from monologue to dialogue opens a dialogue, and it leads to a non-directed and random exchange across the group, and the kind of conversational exchange that discourse is comprised of. It informs us that the group is coming to life. It will falter, fall back, and confound itself many times over. But in this first relational moment, we all become witnesses. And in the act of bearing witness, group therapy begins. Now, I just want to depart from this text to say that in the table you've got on the reverse side, don't turn to it now, but you'll have a chance to look at it. I just want to alert you that the issue of bearing witness features as one of the key elements for which we have a very fine literature to which many of you sitting here have made important contributions. Jonah's question is not only an inquiry, but also a statement of identification and a gift to the group and its therapies. Nothing could have prepared us for it, and it couldn't have been anticipated or rehearsed. These are what we could call portal moments, moments that open the door, in which a sense of mystery, astonishment, and uniqueness transcends technicalities. This is the language of Murray Cox, who was a teacher of such importance to so many of us. This kind of question is also a communication and an answer to a number of other unstated earlier questions. Who are you? How did we all survive? How can we face the extent of human cruelty? What can we do together about the injuries that show on our faces and in our bodies? And I want to pay special appreciation tonight to Annie Douglas, who's here from Scotland, and who I heard give us a presentation using language of a very similar kind with a different population that was such an important education for me. It's also an answer to another unstated question. I will be your brother, he says. Will you be mine? In the moment of his question, he begins to create brotherhood amongst us. These people had lost just about everything: relatives, health, home and country, and their sense of integrity. Generosity emerged as a quality they hadn't lost, and by discovering this, each of them would rebuild their world. Though preoccupied with their own losses, they could recover their dignity through compassion. They settled down to 2 years of productive work, stabilized their lives, began the mourning process of coming to terms, and did so as displaced people in the absence of their customary rituals of mourning and grief work, relying instead on the group itself. And finally, they began to generate a real sense of the future. Vignette 3 captures the mood and emotional texture of long-term therapy as a newcomer's assimilation brings changes to the group as a whole. Whenever George looks at Caroline, she gets furious. "Don't put your depressed eyes on me," she says. "You fill me up with sadness just by looking at me." People are finally able to convince Caroline that it's her susceptibility to take up a depressed position under George's sad eyes that gives them power over her. His projected feelings of wretchedness can only penetrate her because she's wretched in herself. The figuration comes to include Ella, who has been going through a long period of initiation in the group. She's become known for just how much she has to cry about, first in her sad history and then with the breakup of both her marriages. Developing changes become noticeable as she settles and starts talking about her new interest in cooking, including her family's traditional Polish recipes. A narrative emerges in the group about television chefs and their spice recommendations that seem to draw on her own changes. The resonance to her newfound interest fills the room with stories of recipes and accounts of things that different people are learning to cook. The group has amplified her developing sense of nourishment. It would seem to have happened all by itself. The conductor identifies and enhances the symbolic content of the exchanges without interpreting, leading to an amplified resonance in the figuration of nourishment and homemaking. This engenders in the group's reflective climate a new level of understanding about the homes people did not have as children. In another session, there's an emerging sense of sadness projected from one and identified with by the others about a lost childhood. Parental encroachment, abuse, and neglect left them with little capacity to play and a poor sense of enjoyment. The shadows of their sad histories outside emerge in vivid contrast to the sense of something new cooking in the group. Someone says, "The smell of the kitchen in this group has suddenly become delicious." We live out a novel sense of playfulness, and its newfound vitality allows its members to appreciate, during moments of much sadder reflection than any we have known, the shadows that kept their childhoods in darkness. In the aftermath of the play, there is mourning for their childhood hurts that leads on to the reparative dimension we'll look at in the next vignette. I'm going to move straight on to the concluding piece of music. Va Pensiero is the chorus of the Hebrew Slaves. We hear the sound of people's voices raised against servitude and longing for home. It captures some of the movement described above. Giuseppe Verdi composed it as a centerpiece for his opera Nabucco, which, though set in Babylon, 580 BC, was really an account of the plight of the people of Lombardy and Piedmont living under the control of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. He located the narrative in a faraway time and place to get behind the political censors of his day, and within days of its performance in 1852, it was sung all over Italy. It became the song of the Risorgimento, Italy's own war of independence, and it's today the country's unofficial national anthem. I first introduced this music to a teaching seminar with my Israeli colleagues in Haifa 2006 to illustrate mutative metaphors. When I recounted its personal significance in Verdi's biography, we entered the reparative dimension of his life. He was a young composer with two unsuccessful operas to his name when his wife died in childbirth with their second child, who also perished. Their surviving little girl died soon after. For a long time, he was grief-stricken and lost to consolation. Someone finally put a libretto in his pocket and sent him home to set it to music. He got in, threw it to the fire, but it missed and fell open at the words of Psalm 136. If I should forget thee, O Jerusalem. Here the Hebrews, taken captive in their thousands, long for their home. You can hear their longing in the music that became Verdi's own salvation and his own first musical success. You can also hear defiance in the courage of their voices, raised to the vision of a different future. As we discussed this 9 years ago, my colleagues and I began humming it together. Though we did not know its words, the music touched us all, and I'm honored to see so many of you here tonight. Now, the reparative dimension I'm going to have to skate through, and we can come back to it in the discussion that follows. But I'll just give you an outline first of the vignette. It describes an experiential group I conducted at a symposium of the society in Heidelberg 25 years ago. There were 10 of us, many from countries that had been attacked or overrun by Germany during World War II. We met for an hour and a half through the 4 days, and there were two German women, and the interaction between them, Susanna and Sabina, and the rest of the group, especially in the content of the disclosures, illustrates the progression that brought us to the reparative dimension. I want to say I presented this vignette in a keynote presentation to 3DG, the German Group Analytic Umbrella Organization, in Dresden last June, and I'm representing it here with the consent and blessing of the people responsible in Dresden. All of us in the group were born in the post-war period. People were preoccupied with stories of wartime events learned from their parents' generation, now brought to the surface by their visit. Each had a different story to tell. However, Susanna and Sabina were subdued and unforthcoming, and only after a warm alliance had been formed did one of them share some of her history. She was still coming to painful terms with an earlier decision not to have children and used the group to help her grief. She'd fallen pregnant 2 years earlier, and after a short but heavy period of doubt because she wanted to have the baby, decided against it. It was too late in her life to have children. She had no stable relationship in which the baby could grow. Her exchanges in the group helped her see that her unhappy relationships with men had something to do with the complicated history of her early childhood and then a later crisis with her otherwise beloved parents. When a young adult, she'd fallen in love with a man from the Near East, and her parents' rejecting reactions gave her a very intense course in what she called everyday racism. The rupture with her parents damaged their relationship, leaving her with political and moral confusion that she now brought to the group. Her parents had been normal mainstream people of their time, but the link between their racism and the fascism of the country's past left her unable to find a clear way forward at the time, and now it was too late for children. Many of us, first-time witnesses to the burden of history carried by the next generation on the other side, were distressed. We tried to do what we could to help Susanna free herself, and she found that people's efforts to make contact lifted her sense of guilt. But Sabina remained silent, and I'll just run through the story with Sabina and then conclude. Tearful and withdrawn, she finally spoke in our concluding session to tell us she'd been carrying the weight of her mother's depression as a lifelong burden. We explored what part this played in her own decision to become a therapist, and the story unfolded in an unexpected direction. She was born in a small town in the east of Germany, close to the Polish border, on a day in July 1945, when there was still fighting in the area then invaded by the Russians. People were in a state of terror, knowing that the invading soldiers came to rape and pillage. When the Russians banged on the door of their home, her grandmother called out that a baby was being born at that very moment. A Russian officer came in to inspect, and on seeing her mother in labor, was so moved, he made a sign of the cross that he then marked on the door of their home, and he wrote beneath it in Cyrillic. The message described the baby's birth and called for all who lived there to be given security. It was honored throughout the occupation despite the soldiers' despoiling activity elsewhere. Later, her mother fled with her to West Germany, where she'd been raised, and the picture formed by the non-Germans of suffering amongst Germans in the group, of which they'd had no former picture, created a new figuration with reparative significance that had far-reaching consequences for all. 25 years on, I still find it so moving. The story took on new meaning when the group's membership was able to construe this as an account of how the innocence of new life in a baby's birth had saved its mother and her family. The story had powerful symbolic meaning for all. Its reparative significance, expressed through the symbolic voice of a baby's innocence, provided a sense of absolution brought by the newborn with benefits of redemption for her mother and the household. The decisive impact of birth at a critical moment and the continuing presence of a baby's vulnerability halted the blood craze of vengeful soldiers. The group discovered a sense of grace with consequences for both women that touched us all. We began to see how the innocence of those born after the Holocaust could work back to soften the burden that lay on the responsible generation. When Susanna and Sabina could see historical meaning in the hurts of their own upbringing and share this with people from the other side who had similar biographies, they could carry the circumstances of their lives with a new grace that would always be with them. In the primordial domain of the group's common zone, the baby was still there in the grown woman. It brought out in everybody the recognition of a new generation's innocence. The discovery sent us all away as changed people. History isn't destiny. Thank you.
Gwen, please.
Well, what an enormously rich treat we've had from John. And it's obviously an enormous privilege and pleasure to be here as a respondent. Thank you very much to the International Group Adult Association for inviting me for this signal honour. And it's wonderful to be here with so many friends and colleagues. Thank you, John, for a wonderful, very rich talk. And it's, as you can imagine, knowing what was coming, I was still blown away, and I know that we want to have time to think about that. So I know that in the Murray Cox, when Murray Cox gave his Foulkes lecture, Janet Boakes gave him a bunch of flowers. Now, I don't have a bunch of flowers, John, but I have some flowers of thought, I hope, that I'm going to share with you. And what's going to be part of that bunch of flowers is really mainly quotes from a therapy group that I ran, was part of, had the privilege to be part of running for 10 years at Broadmoor Hospital, which is a group for people who killed somebody close to them. And that group was a massive teacher for me, almost as much of a teacher as John has been in my working life. And I'm very grateful for this opportunity to share some material which I hope will illustrate John's triangle and perhaps a couple of other R's as well. And these are the people, again, that I need to acknowledge here, especially the group members who gave their permission for their words to be used. And these are my co-therapists, without whom this work would not be possible, especially Peter Aylward, my supervisor. But just first an association, really, about how what happens when we bring strangers together. Because, of course, in any sort of forensic setting, the men are very much strangers to each other. And the idea of coming together as strangers to develop and find a coherent message, some type of coherent language, is often very foreign to them. And John made a mention of the language that we speak when we don't want to be understood. And that rang a very powerful bell for me as a psychotherapist working with offenders. Because it seems to me that many of the people that I work with, both men and women who've offended, are people who speak in ways where they don't want to be understood, or they're ambivalent about being understood. So this is the language of secrets and lies, and the language of being isolated from others, of not trusting people, and the language that what you can't speak, the unspeakable, when you're suffused with fear and shame and trauma. And when I discussed this once with John about the language I was hearing in the group, John described this as having strange and terrible beauty. And as so often, John, you articulated something perfectly, which really helped me to understand something of what I was hearing in these very strange groups that I was working in. And this seemed like a perfect image. This is a circular keyboard. And I thought, given our reflections on music, this seemed absolutely apposite. Some of you will recognize this is a quote from a famous fictional murderer, but it is a perfect description, I think, of the challenge faced by men and women who have done terrible things and literally cannot think what it is that they have done. So when we invite them to come together into a group, we are inviting them to think about that which they don't want to think about, to think the unthinkable. And this takes me, I think, straight on to the Foulkes different domains that John was talking about, Foulkes different domains of the current and the real and the symbolic and the transferential and the primordial. And this seems to me a very important and helpful way to think about helping people to think when they can't bear to think what they've done. So we think, don't we, that there is that about group analytic psychotherapy that helps people develop and grow more of a social mind. And I've been very interested over the last 10 years or so about the extent to which the group process, doing the group process, builds the pro-social tendency, the opposite of Winnicott's antisocial tendency. And John has been describing these three R's, the reflecting and the relating and reparation. And I wonder if there are also some other R's, at least in the world that I work in, the R's of recovery and the R's of redemption, where redemption refers to getting back something that's been lost. And my colleague Martha Ferrito has published some very interesting work looking at the language of people in the group talking about redemption, and I'm going to say a bit more about that. But now I just really want to go through some quotes from the group with you, and I'm going to read them out. Anything that's in brackets is a therapist speaking. So this is the beginning. This is an early session from one of our homicide groups. So this is one of the group members speaking. If Sam talks about football, it's not relevant. But we get to know about him as a person. But this isn't the getting to know each other group, it's the homicide group. Why homicide? Yes, why? Why not murder? I don't think I like murder. You make it sound more serious. Murder sounds so graphic. Why is everyone so fascinated by murder? Waking the Dead, Midsummer Murder. For those of you who don't know, these are names of British television programs, and it's true, there's something on British television every night about murder. Every night on TV, you can watch something about murder. And then there was a pause, and one of the men said, if you get 7 or 8 crows together, you call it a murder. And then another man said, in Broadmoor, there's a myth that the crows are the souls of dead staff. So here's something that illustrates relating. This is again a man speaking. I've been reading this book. It's my favorite. It's William Shakespeare's collected plays, Henry V, the night before the Battle of Agincourt. And he's giving this speech about the men in England who aren't there, how they should be there, and how one day they will roll their sleeves up and show their scars. It's that quote. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers. I guess there are only a few of you here in this group. Yes, I suppose we are like a group of brothers. We show our scars here, not our physical scars, our mental scars. And here is a reflective moment. Joe is a man with a chronic psychotic illness. He doesn't say very much. His mental illness is very obvious. And one day he says very loudly in the group, I can't hear a word. And another man says, not unkindly, you are only deaf on a Thursday. And again, this is another moment with Joe. Joe's muttering in the group, and one of the therapists says, Joe, I can't hear what you're saying very well when it's a mutter. And suddenly Joe says very clearly, I was thinking about the lady I killed and how I would like to say sorry. When I killed my mum, I was mentally ill, but there was no reason for me to kill the second lady. Now, this is a particularly remarkable quote, because again, partly because this is a man with a very severe and pronounced psychotic illness, but here is somebody articulating very clearly a philosophical conundrum and a very powerful issue in law about the extent to which I know what I was doing, whether I had a reason to do something. I had no reason to kill this person, but I had, when I was mentally ill, I killed somebody. So this person is really working very hard on something very profound about agency and intention. Say, this is a man said to be psychotic, traditionally excluded, often excluded from psychological therapies. Oh, he can't join your group, Gwen, he's too mad. Recovery. I've been thinking about Star Trek. I apologize for those of you who've never seen Star Trek. This is not going to make much sense if you've never seen Star Trek, but just you'll have to put yourselves on, just hold yourselves in patience for a moment. I've been thinking about Star Trek, about the Prime Directive. What's that? When they explore a new planet, they're not allowed to interfere with the people there, the culture, to change things. Isn't that what we do here in the group? Explore strange new worlds. Boldly go where no one's gone before. You do know that I don't actually think we're on the Enterprise. Again, that was a man, again, it was also, again, a very pronounced, long psychotic illness he'd killed when he was psychotic, and someone who had made very good use of the group. But this playing with the idea of his madness was very profound for him to be able to play in that way I think was a very good example of what the recovery that we think might be possible through the process of being in a group with other people. And then a redemptive moment, just a very simple reflection. If I can make something of my life, then she will not have died in vain, and two lives will not be lost. So many of you, of course, will know this lovely image. And it seemed to me when we're talking about music and the musicality of groups, there is also, for me, some notion of the dance. And the in Greek, the perichoresis, the idea of the dance around and the movement and the shifting of different states. And I think what John seems to me to be describing is this very profound movement, constant dynamic movement of different states of mind and different processes, from the relating, which is not always comfortable, to the reflective and the reparative, with the possibility, perhaps, particularly for people who are mentally ill, of recovery. And it seems to me that, therefore, as conductors, we might have to ensure that there's a musical structure that connects these movements, that our job might be to paying close attention to the beat and the rhythm, the volume of speech, that it's our job to keep that thread going. And certainly what we found in the Thursday and the Friday groups in the hospital where I used to work was it was an important part of our job as group therapists to keep bringing the group back to the theme and the beat of the topic of the group, which was about a traumatic event in which somebody and lives have been lost, but also to keep people moving and playing with the ideas of what of their identities now in this life after death. And I want to close by sharing a quote from a 16th century poet, which seems to me to have a beautiful description of the process in group therapy, which when I first read it spoke to me. I was a trainee, very much a trainee group analyst, and this verse spoke to me. It's by a man called Sir John Davis, and it's from a poem appropriately called Orchestra. Since when they are all carried in a round and changing, come in one another's place, yet do they neither mingle nor confound, but every one doth keep the bounded space wherein the dance doth bid it turn or trace. This wondrous miracle did love devise, for dancing is love's proper exercise. Thank you very much.